Aren't you thankful we've got a Bible? Aren't you thankful we've got a book that's absolutely perfect, pure, powerful, precious? Thank God for the book this morning. I really ain't got nothing to say to you outside of the book. I don't got anything to say to you with opinion, conjecture, newsworthy moments. If it wasn't for the book this morning, we might as well just go on to the house. But I sure am thankful for the book this morning. I'm thankful I can base my, not just my temporal life here on it, but I've based my eternity on it. I'm glad that I know that it's true. I want you to get John chapter 3 in one hand, and do me a favor, get Numbers chapter 21 in the other hand. Jesus makes a statement in John chapter 3 about an Old Testament story that we find in Numbers in chapter 21. So I want to read just a few verses out of John chapter 3, and then we'll go from there to our text, which will be Numbers chapter 21. I like what one author said. He said, "The Old Testament is the New Testament concealed, and the New Testament is the Old Testament revealed." Nothing could be any more clearer about that statement than what we will be looking at this morning. What was hid in the mind of God and concealed in Numbers 21 was revealed and made known to the hearts of men in John chapter 3 from the lips of our very Savior this morning. John chapter 3, let's just begin reading in verse 1. We'll read several verses of Scripture here down to our text. John 3, verse number 1, if you're with me, say amen. Amen. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, "Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God. For no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him." Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." I like how the Lord just cuts straight to the point here. I'm sure Nicodemus, Brother Skip, when he walked up there to see Jesus by night, I'm sure he kind of thought maybe the Lord's going to be impressed by his social status. Sure, he probably thought, "The Lord is really probably going to shake my hand," kind of bow his head, say, "Man, it is, whoa, man, ruler of the Jews, it is, man, you got a lot of prestige and power and money. It's so good to have you." Instead, Jesus looked right at him. He said, "I'm going to tell you something, Nicodemus. If you don't get born again, you'll never go to heaven." I mean, somebody that is steeped in tradition and steeped in religion and steeped in, "I'm going to heaven because I'm a good person." And Jesus looks right at him and says, "You don't even know how to get to heaven." Wow, what a blow to the pride. Can I say this message might follow along in the vein of the Lord this morning? I may injure or wound your pride. If I do just WWJD it, what would Jesus do? He would wound your pride this morning. If you're a self-righteous individual that's counting on yourself to get yourself to heaven, I'm probably going to wound your pride. I'm just acting like my Savior does. Yeah, I know that's not the Jesus we've heard about, but that's the Jesus of the Bible. Verse number 4, Nicodemus saith unto them, "How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of water," that's your first birth, your natural birth, "and of the Spirit," got to be a second birth, "he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh," that water birth, that first birth, "and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit," the second birth, the spiritual birth. Verse 7, "Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. The wind bloweth where it listeth. I just quoted this verse a moment ago. And thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is every one that is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus answered and said unto him, how can these things be? Jesus answered and said unto him, art thou a master of Israel and knowest not these things? How belittling. I mean, really, how belittling. He's already wounded his pride once, and now he says, I don't understand it, and now Jesus is making fun of him. Ain't you a master and ruler? How come you don't know this stuff? How belittling. I love the Lord. He's such a character. Verse 11, verily, verily, I say unto thee, we speak that we do know and testify that we have seen, and ye receive not our witness. Verse 12, if I have told you earthly things and ye believe not, how shall ye believe if I tell you of heavenly things? Once again, pause, time out. Don't you remember last Sunday when I told you God's preferred method of teaching men spiritual truths? God's preferred method of teaching men spiritual truths is to show them something on an earthly plane that they can understand, and then he likens it to something on a heavenly and a spiritual plane. Jesus is doing exactly what I told you he likes to do last week. Jesus is telling Nicodemus about something he understands. Birth, natural birth, coming into the world. He's telling him something he knows about. Wind blowing in the trees, wind blowing over the water. And he says, what I'm going to try and show you in the spiritual realm is like that. It's like birth. It's like wind. And he's going to give us another one here. This is the one I'm really wanting to key in on. Verse 13, he said, and no man hath ascended up to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, speaking of himself, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. Now watch verse 14. And I told you there's two words God likes to teach with. The word like and the word as. Comparison. Earthly truth, heavenly meaning. Verse 14, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Y'all know these verses. I love these verses. Let's just keep reading them because they're too good to pass up. That whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Do you see what he just did? He gave us the earthly story of Moses and the serpent, and now he's likening it to something spiritual that's going to take place. Verse 17, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. Nicodemus comes to the Lord and he knows nothing about a new birth. He knows nothing about a cross. He knows nothing about the Holy Spirit living inside of an individual. Those are the three things the Lord highlights. New birth, the Spirit of God taking up residence in an individual, and Calvary, the substitutionary death of himself that would take place in the future just some time after this. And Nicodemus knows nothing about it. So the way the Lord is going to illustrate one of these truths, which is the one I want to key in on this morning, the truth of the cross, the truth of the Lord dying for the sins of the world, is he says, Nicodemus, I'm going to tell you what this is going to be like. It is like this. It is as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness. And just as Moses did that, God is going to lift his Son up on a cross. And just like they looked and lived, whoever will look and live can have eternal life. With that in mind, I want you to come to our story, the earthly story that Jesus is getting at, and go back to Numbers 21. And I'm preaching this morning. I preached last Sunday on God as an eagle. This morning, I'd like to preach on God as a serpent. God as the serpent. I want you to notice Numbers chapter number 21 and begin reading in verse number 4. Numbers 21 verse 4, the Bible said, and they journeyed from Mount Hor by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom. And the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. And the people spake against God and against Moses, wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loatheth this light bread. And the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, and much people of Israel died. Therefore the people came to Moses and said, we've sinned, for we've spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent, and set it upon a pole. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. There are amazing truths that we find in Numbers 21 as it relates to several things. As it relates to you and I as sinners condemned under the hand of God, and as it relates to our Savior, the one that is in the business of redeeming sinners from the condemnation of God and redeeming sinners from our sin. So I want to show you several truths in this text, and just hang with me. We're going to get to the part as God as the serpent. We're going to get to that part of the Son of God being the picture of this serpent, but we've got to lay some groundwork throughout our message as we do. Can I give you this real quick? And we'll be through this morning. Let me show you, number one, we see the entrance of the serpents. We find that there was an entrance or an emergence of these serpents. Did you notice when the serpents came? Notice when the serpents that bit these people slithered up. They didn't come until after verse 5, where the Bible said that they spake against God and said, wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water, and our soul loatheth this light bread. And then the Lord sent fiery serpents. The snakes, the serpents, they enter after an act of rebellion, defiance, and murmuring against the Lord this morning. Here we find God's people, they're not satisfied with what God gave. They're not satisfied with what God provided. Let me just pause right here and say, even those of us that are saved, can we not find ourselves in this text this morning? The songwriter said, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Many times we're not satisfied with what God's put in our life. We're not satisfied with what God gave. We're always looking for something bigger and something better and something more. And we're never satisfied with what God has entrusted us with. That's what got mankind in the problem originally. They weren't happy with what God gave. Weren't happy with what God provided. Weren't happy with the way God set it up. I know better. I can do it better. I got a better way. I got a better plan. Let me say this. No, you don't this morning. Your plan stinks and God's plan's good this morning. Your plan will take you to hell. God's plan will take you to heaven. If you're saved, your plan will wind you up in a hog pen and a ditch. And if you're saved, God's plan will keep you out the ditch and keep you in the house of God and keep you right with God and in the will of God this morning. You want to know why we've got a generation of rebels that even are in our society and in our homes and families and churches? Because now for years, Hollywood has pumped this rebellion idea of not being satisfied into our kids. Yeah, every Disney cartoon that has come out for the last 25 or 30 years was totally predicated on don't be satisfied with what mama give you and daddy give you and what you have. You need to be a rebel and go against the authority in your life. Yeah, I mean, let's just be honest. We watch it too, but let's be honest. What is this? Let it go, let it go. Don't hold it back anymore. You know, y'all didn't think I could sing opera or whatever they do on Broadway. Let it go, let it go. You know, turn away and slam the door. I don't care what they're gonna say. Yeah, you know what that is? That's your rebellion, sis. That's it's okay to be gay. Yeah, yeah, that's, yeah, surely y'all smart,
Surely y'all are smart enough to see behind the sweet little story of Anna and Elsa and see what they're really getting at. I got this thing that everybody's going to pick on me about if I let come out, and they won't accept it, but just let it go. You know, you feel an urge to be gay. Don't worry what mama says or daddy says or that mean old nasty preacher says. Don't worry about what they say about your lifestyle. Don't worry about what they say about your sin. Just come out and let it go. Do your own thing. Surely you're smart enough to realize what was going on in Aladdin when Aladdin and his little girlfriend decided she wasn't happy living in the palace where daddy had provided her everything. Daddy had given her clothes and money and popularity, but I'm not satisfied with that. I want something else. Don't want that. Not satisfied with that. Surely you can see the Lion King and little old Simba. He's not happy to live in the boundaries that what daddy set up. Don't go into the dark part, Simba. I'm not satisfied to live in the boundaries that my daddy set up. I'm going to go do what daddy says I can't do. I'm going to enjoy my... Surely you can see Pinocchio, some of you older people. I'm not satisfied to be what my maker made me to be. I want to be something else. I want to be something different. Surely you can see what Ariel is on The Little Mermaid. I'm not happy to be down here living the substandard, poor, depraved life that I don't get what I want down here. I want more than what I'm getting down here under the sea. So am I making sense to anybody this morning? See, some of y'all just watch that stuff and let your kids watch that stuff, and I let my kids watch it too, but you mark this down. I've always been preaching at them while we're watching it. Brother John, we ain't never watched one of them movies, but what I did while I was sitting there, I'd tell them, me and my wife, that girl's wrong, that boy's wrong, daddy's right, mama's right, the authority's right. Absolutely. Where have I heard all of this before? Brother Zach, where have I heard all this before? Not satisfied with this, don't like this. That's right. Genesis 3. Brother Chip, I heard it with Eve. Ain't y'all heard it with Eve?
Yeah.
You know when the snake emerged? When the snake entered? It's when Eve started checking out that tree. I mean, come on, put your thinking caps on. Do you know why when the serpent showed up in Genesis 3, the first thing he said is, "Yea, hath God said you should not eat of every tree of the garden?" Why did he show up and talk about that, Brother Bill? I'll tell you why. Because he had already seen her walking around looking at it. And the devil always tempts you with what you are already being drawn away with your own lust and being tempted with. And the serpent emerged in Genesis 3 after she had already started thinking, you know, I think God's given me the short change. I think God's just not letting me enjoy my life. I think God's just keeping me back from enjoying something that I really want to enjoy. And so it was only natural the devil was going to show up and help feed the rebellion that was already in her life this morning. Won't y'all listen to me? Won't y'all listen to me this morning? Listen to what I'm going to say. It is hard to stop the direction of a rebel when they start looking that way. Eve started looking at the tree, and she wasn't stopped till she got it. Lot started looking at Sodom, and he didn't stop till he got it. Adam started looking at Bathsheba, and he didn't stop till he got her. The prodigal started looking at the far country, and he didn't stop till he got it. I'll tell you this. I want y'all to understand something. Once an individual, once a young person, once a young man or a young lady starts murmuring against the church and murmuring against the rules and the standards at the church and at home, and mom and dad, you mark this down, it's going to be hard to stop them. They're headed in a different direction. What is it? It's rebellion. You know when the snake shows up to bite? It's when you already start leaning towards an area of rebellion in your life. I told you we're going to get to the good part. I got to offend you before I can help you here, all right? Isn't this amazing? Isn't this amazing? This blew my mind, Brother John. What they are rebelling about, Brother Matthew, it ain't even true. Did you notice it? Watch what they said. It's not true. Watch verse 5 of chapter 21. They said, there is no bread. Lie. God's raining down bread. You just don't like what God's given out. Second lie. Neither is there any water. No water? Oh, time out. No. We ain't going to let them off that easy. Go to chapter 20. Back up one chapter. Chapter 20, And watch what your Bible said. Chapter 20 and verse 11. One chapter earlier, they said, we ain't got no bread. That's a lie. They got bread. They said, we ain't got no water. That's a lie. Chapter 20, verse 11. And Moses lifted up his hand with his rod. He smote the rock twice. And the water came out abundantly. And the congregation drank. And there was so much water, their beasts also. You say, well, then why are they saying what they're saying in verse 5? Because a rebel will always make up excuses for why they are the victim. A rebel will always make up excuses why I'm the victim in this thing. No, you ain't. You're backslidden. You're wicked, rebellious as hell. And I don't care how much you've duped your mama, your daddy, or your grandparents, or nobody else into believing it. I ain't buying it this morning. This victimhood mentality. Oh, I'm just not. No. Your heart ain't right. It's the Eve victim mentality. It's the Eve victimhood. God's just trying to keep you back from enjoying your life, Eve. God doth know that the day you eat it, you'll surely die. It's the woe is me. It's the I got, no, you ain't got problems this morning. God been good to you. Amen. Sit there and say, well, I just all these rules and all these standards. Yeah, thank God for them. You know what the rules and the standards were for in Genesis 3? To keep them from getting bit from a snake. All you young people in here need to listen up. You know what the rules and the standards in the church and such as that's for? It's to keep you safe. It's to keep you from walking down a path where you're going to mess your life up and have regrets and have scars. It's not mean old preacher and mean old preacher. No, it's to try and keep you from going down a path you'll regret one day. We see the entrance of the serpents. When did they show up? They showed up when they started rebelling. I'm moving here. We see not only the entrance of the serpents, we see the evil of the serpents. Look at the evilness of the serpents. It said this in verse 6. It says this several times, that these serpents were fiery serpents. Amen. I looked up that word fiery, and Brother Joe, the word fiery, it literally means they were just poisonous. They carried this fiery poison that when they would bite these individuals, it'd be like fire running through their veins. It would hurt them, Brother Danny. And this poison just literally made them feel like they were about to explode from the inside out. These serpents, when they struck, they didn't just strike with no purpose. They struck to hurt. They struck to harm. And they left the effect of their venom. You say, what's the effect of their venom? It's found in verse 6. When they bit the people, verse 6, much people of Israel died. What happens after they bite them? Pain, death, regret, sorrow. Can you imagine how bad somebody feels? You know, I thought about this, Brother Skip. This just crossed my mind. It says much people died. You know what I believe? I believe this morning probably that some of the people that died wasn't even the ones that was doing the rebelling. But because of the rebellion of others, it has now cost these people. I can see maybe a daddy or a mama holding their baby, and this baby didn't rebel, this baby didn't say nothing, but this child is hurting, this child is harmed. Mom and daddy's thinking, oh my God, I wish I hadn't said nothing about God. I wish I hadn't rebelled. I wish I'd just kept walking with the Lord. Look what I've now caused in my life. I'll tell you what, the wages of sin is still death. There is a cost and there is a consequence for sin getting in our life and in our world. The Bible said, wherefore as by one man sin entered into the world, one man's rebellion has now caused billions upon billions to now be infected down through generation after generation with the nature of sin in their life, and the poison has passed to everyone. Can I just give you a news update? You're infected this morning. You're an infected individual this morning. If you're saved, God has done something about the infection to where it doesn't take you to hell. But if you're lost this morning, your infection is not only killing you physically, it will kill you spiritually for all eternity in a lake of fire this morning. It's in your veins. Somebody said, bad, bad to the bone. Yeah, that's you. You got a nature inside of you. The life of the flesh is in the blood, and we are just bad to the very bone this morning. And people think they can play with sin. People think I'm going to mess with sin. I'm going to play with sin. And I'm going to come out unscathed. No, you won't. I'm reminded, Brother David, of a message I preached years ago on sin is like a snake. I hate snakes. I think there's a reason why the Lord likens himself to a snake is because there's nothing more nasty that he could liken himself to, that when he died on the cross, he was taking that on himself, than a snake. I hate snakes. Oh, they ain't no good ones. Live ones, real ones, dead ones, rubber ones, fake ones, they all from hell. You say, oh, not them, you know, not them black, not them little black snakes and them right there. They good snakes, and I don't, hey, good. Amy said, hey, they eat the rodents and they eat the bad snakes. Good. They need to do it out in the woods somewhere because they come up in my yard and I'm going to kill them. Yeah. All you snake activists out there, don't be bringing you black snakes over here. If it's slithering, it's going to die. And I doubt I'm going to get close enough to it to even hit it with a shovel. My prescribed method of dealing with snakes is 12 gauge from about 15 feet away. See, that tears it all to pieces. Yeah, duh. That was my goal. Evaporation. Amen. Now, I remember Brother Tyler reading a story one time. They said down in Florida, There was a mama that was staying at home one day, and she was in the house and at the kitchen and doing some work, and she had a little baby boy, just a little toddler fella. And she got to hearing him at the back door down the hall. This is a true story. And got to hearing him down the hall, and she could hear the screen door open. And when she would hear that door open, she would hear it slam shut. And every time the door would slam shut, Brother Steve, she would hear that little toddler boy go, ha, 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 ha. And she'd hear that door squeak open, and then she'd hear it slam, and it'd slam, that little boy, ha, 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 ha. She thought, what is that youngin' done? And she walked around the corner and looked down the hall, and what she saw made her blood run cold. She looked down the hall, and what was going on was sitting just on the back porch on the other side of this storm door was a rattlesnake coiled up in the position ready to strike. And that child would push that door open, nothing inhibiting that poisonous, venomous, fiery snake from jumping out and striking that child right in the face. And that child would open that door, and he would let it go. And every time he would let it go, when the door would slam, the snake would strike at the door right in that child's face. The only thing stopping the venom, the only thing stopping the sure destruction was that door. And every time they would hit that child right in the face, and the door would stop it, the child would... Say, man, what a wild story. Yeah, it ain't no wilder than some of y'all sitting here this morning. You keep opening the door, opening the entrance to some things in your life. Now I'm telling you, if they hadn't already bit you, they gonna bite you. And it's gonna infect you, and it's gonna mess your home up and mess your life up, and it's gonna take you down a path you'd wish you never went down. You can't play with sin this morning. I am reminded of that goofy nut that ended up dying by getting a stingray barb through his heart. They called him the crocodile hunter. That was from my day. How many of y'all remember old crocodile hunter Steve Irwin? Dude was nuts. Say, ain't you sad he's dead? I mean, look, I hate it for his family and all, but come on, anybody that stupid, it bound to happen, friend. He'd walk up into these places, you know, where these super venomous, poisonous snakes. And they'd be all around, and they'd be sitting there ready to strike, and he'd get down and he'd say, this is the most poisonous snake in the whole world. This is the most venomous snake in the planet. One drop of its venom can kill a man. I'm gonna touch it. No, you ain't gonna. Yeah, I'm gonna touch. No, you ain't. Yeah, he'd touch it and food get bit. Time after time after time, they had antivenom there to give him to help keep him alive. Some of y'all this morning, you just like the crocodile hunter. I know what the preacher says. I know what the Bible says. I know whatever they said. But I'm gonna keep touching it. And I'm gonna keep getting away with it. One of these times it's gonna strike. Yeah. I'm talking about we see the evil of the serpents, and then we see the entrance of the serpents. Let me give you some good news. Can I give you some good news this morning, and we'll let you go? I like the good news. That's all the bad news I got. Let's go to the good news. We see there was an escape from the serpents this morning. What's the escape from the serpents? Oh, I like it. Look at verse number 7. Verse 7 of Numbers 21. This is where the Lord comes in. The Lord says, this is what I'm like. Therefore, verse 7, the people came to Moses and said, we have sinned. Time out. That's a real good way to get help this morning. You will never get the kind of help spiritually that you need until you can admit, I have sinned. It's not my brother, it's not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It is me. I have sinned. King of Moses, we've sinned, for we've spoken against the Lord and against thee. Pray unto the Lord that he take away the serpents from us. And Moses prayed for the people. And the Lord said unto Moses, make thee a fiery serpent. This is just what Jesus said he was a picture of. And set it upon a pole. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is bitten, when he looketh upon it, shall live. And Moses made a serpent of brass and put it upon a pole. And it came to pass that if a serpent had bitten any man, when he beheld the serpent of brass, he lived. I love this. I love the fact that God had a solution for the pollution this morning. God had a plan. God made a provision. Aren't you so glad that when they came and said, Brother Jack, we've sinned, God didn't say, tough apples. Kick rocks. Just go on and die. No. But when these broken-hearted rebels, when these broken-hearted sinners said, oh God, we realize the error of our way. We realize we messed up. God, brother, had made a provision this morning. You say, what's the provision? I love this. Don't miss the provision. God said, check us out. I want you to make a likeness of the fiery serpents. Now, it ain't the fiery serpent, but it's made in the likeness of the fiery serpent. It looks like the fiery serpent, but this serpent of brass didn't have no venom in him. This snake on the pole, yes, it looked like the serpents on the ground, and it was bearing the judgment of those that had been bit on the ground. Matter of fact, it's a serpent of brass. Brass in your Bible is always a picture of judgment. Yes, it's bearing the judgment. Yes, the sins of these people are falling on that snake, but this snake has not done anything wrong. There's no evil venom in this snake. It looks like the other snakes, but it's not the same. And God said, this is a matter of faith. Anyone who's been bit, if they will just look at that, just believe that if you get a look, it can heal you and save you. By faith, I'll heal you. By faith, I'll do something about what's going on the inside of your body, and I'll heal you. Can you imagine, Brother Zeke, what the messenger sounded like for this? I mean, I just got to think maybe the messengers was probably these folks sitting around there. I mean, they're hurting. They're dying. They're laying there. Oh, they're wailing and crying out. Their body is on fire and they're hurting down to their very bones. They know death is coming. And about that time, Moses says, if you'll just look, you can live. If you look, you can live. Some old broken down rebel, that's getting what he deserves. He deserves it. That old broken down rebel, Brother Donald, just says, I believe. I believe. And he looks up, and when he gets a glimpse by faith of that snake on the pole, all of a sudden something happens in his body. There's a healing that starts on the inside and works its way to the outside. And he stands up and says, praise God, it worked. Can you imagine? He starts running everywhere. He starts saying, hey, just look, 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 just look, look. And about that time, by that time people say, I've tried religion before. It don't work. I'm hurting. Leave me alone. No, no, look, just look. I don't believe it. I'm hurting. Keep your religion. Keep your preaching. I'm too bad a shape for that snake to help me. I've tried turning over a new leaf since I've been laying here. I've had the priest come by, and I've joined the church since I've been laying here, and it ain't helped me. I've been laying here quoting the rosary. I was laying here and got sprinkled and confirmed. I'm waiting on somebody to come baptize me. It can't be that simple. Oh, yeah. I'm telling you, it's that simple. They say, how do you know it's that simple? Because I was laying up there dying. I was dying up there. I got bit by the snake, too. And I looked. I just looked by faith. And now here I stand. I'm whole and I'm well. Just look. You say, preacher, this is the craziest crowd I've been around in my life. They shouting about a story that happened 4,000 years ago. Preacher, they shouting about a snake. That's because they're seeing the as Moses lifted up the serpent. They're seeing the like Moses. They're not seeing the serpent. They're looking beyond what the serpent represents. And 2,000 years ago, God sent one down in the likeness of sinful flesh. And for sin, condemned sin in the flesh. He looked like a sinner, but he wasn't a sinner this morning. He had no sin in him. He was the God of glory. He was the Son of God. And they lifted his broken, bruised body up on the cross of Calvary. And now any sinner, man, woman, boy, or girl, rich or poor, red, yellow, black, and white, can look toward the cross by faith and receive a complete, total healing of their sin this morning. You say, preacher, how do you know that this stuff works? Because, Brother Danny, I was the fella laid up over there, infected by my sin. Now I was the one that heard the simple gospel message that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners and that God so loved us that he gave his only begotten son. One night as an 18-year-old boy, I took my eyes off religion. And I took my eyes off a preacher. And I took my eyes off things. You know what I did? By faith, I looked toward the cross. And when by faith I looked toward the cross, believing that can heal me, that can save me. Brother Chris, it did this morning. I stand before you, not a perfect man, still a sinner man, but the debt of my sin was paid, and the condemnation of my sin is gone, and the weight of my sin has been lifted, and the penalty of my sin has been paid for, because one day it laid on the back of God's Son on a cross. I am the one by the highway on that road to Jericho when I heard that Jesus of Nazareth, he was coming down the road. And I cried, thou Son of David, Lord, have mercy on me. Then someone said, he's calling you, and I met the Nazarene. And I am that crippled man in the way. I am the blind and lame. I am that dead man buried. so unclean, but now I've victory. Listen to me. All I can say is I had no hope, but I met the Nazarene. I'm going by you, Brother Mark. I am the one before you now who humbly testifies. I was blind and lame. I was dead in my sin. But I heard he was passing by. And I cried unto him, how could you, Lord, ever love someone like me? Now all I know is I was blind, but I met the Nazarene.
Say, preacher, how in the world can I escape from the venom of the sin that has caused me to rebel? The sin of my life that's taken me to hell? Just look and live. Just look and live. Say, it can't be that simple. Can I tell you what God said? Can I tell you what God said? Brother Kent, God said this. Isaiah 44:22 Isaiah 44:22 He said, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth, for I'm God, and there is none else. Say, preacher, how do I go to heaven? Don't look at this preacher. I can't get you nowhere. Don't look at the deacon. He can't get you nowhere. Don't look at the church members. They can't get you nowhere. Oh, but this morning we have showed up to exalt and lift up the one who took upon himself the form of a servant. And the Bible said he who knew no sin became sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And on the cross when he was lifted up, he bore my judgment, bore my sin, bore my wrath. And if by faith you'll just turn towards Jesus, you can have life this morning. Esther, come help me over here. I'm done. I'm so glad the Lord said, as Moses lifted up that serpent, just like that, on that cross, I was lifted up for you. Speaking of snakes and venom, I'll give you this and I'm through. There was a man who was a contemporary, almost everybody in here that's been to school, you've heard of Louis Pasteur. Louis Pasteur had a friend who was a Jew whose name was Albert Calmet. I'm sorry, Albert Calmet was a contemporary of Louis Pasteur. It wasn't the Jew, that was Felix Roux. But Albert Calmet decided he was tired. He was laboring in Vietnam. And he was tired of watching people die from venomous, fiery snake bites. And they said, Brother J.C., that a flood, which was prone to do in the wet season, came through a village in Vietnam. And when the water receded, it just left hundreds upon hundreds of venomous, viper-type water moccasins all through that village. Said children were getting bit, adults were getting bit, folk was dying left and right, and they had no way to help them. He was so frustrated, Brother Mark, about this. He said, I'm going to do something about it. He remembered how Louis Pasteur and Felix Roux healed the black diphtheria in Paris all those years ago. So he started working, and this is what he did. He would take those snakes, milk the venom out of them. And he would take the venom and he would put it into a healthy animal, goat, cow, horse, some healthy animal. And he would inject enough of it that it would almost kill that animal. I mean, it'd take it down to almost nothing, Brother Udi. And they would start watching that animal. Slowly but surely, the animal would get better and it would get well. And that's how they would get the venom. They still get anti-venom this way. It was a little more primitive back then, but this is how they got it. Because that animal survived the venom, the antivenom is in the overcomer's bloodstream. They would kill that animal, draw its blood out, and use the blood of that animal as the antivenom to give to others.
people began to get bit, but they began to get well because immediately they'd come with that antivenom made from the blood of the overcomer's system to inject them with. You know, this morning I've been preaching about sin and how it infects all of our life. But I'm so glad the Bible said that the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. So what do you mean, preacher? I say on the cross, he took sin upon him. And they thought they'd killed him. And he died. Oh, but 3 days later, he was the overcoming lamb. And the overcoming lamb got up. And now the healing for all nations, the healing for everybody in this room this morning, is found in the blood of the overcomer. And if you'll come this morning by faith and just look and live, just look and live, God will change your life. God will give you a spiritual healing. I don't know the crowd necessarily. I know some of you, but I don't know everybody I'm preaching to as far as what your spiritual condition is. I cannot see the heart. But this morning, there's a God in heaven that knows the heart of every individual in here. And he knows whether you fled to the cross for escape or if you're still trying to do your own thing, live your own way. Maybe this morning you are a saved individual, but you live in that rebellion life against God, living in that rebellion stage against the Lord. Won't you come to him this morning and say, Lord, I'm running to you. I'm needing some help and I'm running to you. Let's all stand this morning, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Father, we need your help. We readily admit and acknowledge we have no help besides you. We stand in need of your help. We implore your help. God, I pray one sinner would come and look and live. Maybe some saved person living their life in a spot of rebellion. They'd quit being the Eve victim and they'd run to the Lord, get their heart right. We'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. No one's looking around. I want to ask you a question this morning while you're standing there in the stillness of this moment. You say, preacher, some of what you're preaching on's me. Preacher, I'm not saved. Preacher, I'm lost. That's me, preacher. I'm lost. Preacher, I've never looked and lived. But this morning, by faith, I'd like to look toward Jesus. You've looked toward religion. You've looked toward your own self. Won't you start looking toward the Lord? Say, preacher, I'm lost. Pray for me. Would there be one in here that's never trusted Christ? You'd slip your hand up right now in the stillness of this moment while no one's looking around at me and God and say, preacher, I'm not saved. Will you pray for me? Would there be one like that right now? Just slip your hand up, back down. God bless you, sir. Would there be another that would join this one and say, I'm not saved. I've never looked and lived, never trusted Christ. Sure don't want to leave lost without God and go to hell. Preacher, pray for me. Would there be another? Sir, I'm going to pray for you, but me praying for you won't save you. I wish you'd come and trust Christ this morning. I'm going to pray for you. While I'm praying, Brother Jack's going to sing. Brother Skip, would you get your Bible and stand down front here? If you want to trust Christ, I wish you'd come this morning and meet Brother Skip down front. He'll take a Bible and lead you to Jesus. Don't you hold on to nothing. Let go and come to Jesus. Help this young man, Brother Casey here. Help Casey here. Father, I pray you'd help this one that's come, fled to Jesus for rest. I pray this morning others would quit trusting themselves. Oh, God. Start looking toward Jesus. I pray, God, you'd make the gospel so very clear this morning to this young man that came. I've been praying for him. Pray that you'll help him now trust Christ. Oh, God, move, I pray in Jesus' name. Pray, church. Pray, church. Some are down here getting serious needs help this morning. One's down here calling on God for salvation. Keep singing, Brother Jack. Come just like you are. Brother Hunter, I read that story. And nobody could fix themselves before they looked at the snake on the pole. You couldn't say, Brother Carl, they couldn't say, well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to get better and then I'll take a look at the serpent. No. You can't get better and then start looking. You get better because you looked. You get better because you believed.
And fears
have by faith you ever looked. Look toward Christ. Trust Him. The gospel is as simple as Acts 16:31. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. We've tried to complicate it. We've tried to muddy it up. But the gospel is so simple. Look and live. Look and live. Believe on the Lord Jesus. Look at a man dying on a cross. Look at an empty tomb. He done all that for you. Every bit of it for you. If you know this song, sing with Brother Jack this morning. Thy promise
I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. I come. Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to just as I am, and waiting on to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot. Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, and cause thy promise I be.
This is Casey, and this is Macy. Most of y'all know her. This is Brother Ben Davis' granddaughter. Macy texted me about a week or so ago, and she texted me a long text and said, you know, some things is going on in their life, and she said, you know, I'd maybe like some counseling, things of that nature. And I told her this. I said, Macy, I'll tell you the best thing I can do for you before I ever counsel you, the best thing I can do for you is preach to you. I said, and I'll tell you what I'll do. If you'll commit to coming every service, Sunday school, Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Thursday night for 3 straight weeks, every service, I'll sit down and we'll counsel. I said, but I want you to come every service that you can. And ever since then, Brother Mike Stogner, they have been at every service. They even went to Lexington with us. Casey, Thursday night, after we had that blowout service, Casey come up on the platform. I could tell the Lord been working on him. He said, you know, just thank you for letting us come. And man, I'm glad they're here. And he's crying. I said, I'm praying for you. And this morning I watched as the Lord troubled the waters of his soul. He came this morning, responded to the gospel, and got born again. I thank God for that. Listen, this young family needs all the prayers that we can give them. They got a new baby girl. That baby needs a mom and daddy to bring her up in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. The devil's going to fight them, especially now that the head of the home has trusted Christ and wants to do right. The devil's going to fight this young couple. We want to pray for them. We want to confirm our love to them. This girl's got a good heritage. Her mama's, is Miss Wendy in here? She's with the baby. She's in the nursery taking care of the baby. Thank you, Miss Wendy. She got a good heritage. We need to pray for them. Brother Skip, you and Miss Sheila, do me a favor. Stand with them in the back. Would y'all stand back there so that folk can hug your neck, let you know that they love you and are going to be praying for you? His name is Casey, and that's Macy. Brother Skip, Miss Sheila, going to meet y'all in the back. I want y'all to walk by there. You fellas hug his neck. Tell him you're going to pray for him. Mean it. Write his name down somewhere. He's going to need all the praying he can get. You ladies walk by her, hug her neck. Tell her I love you and that you're going to pray for her. Mean it. I appreciate them being here this morning. I'm glad the gospel still works. Simple little old message about Jesus dying on the cross. Simple little message. They still work. There wasn't nothing super deep about what I just preached. But I sure am glad it don't got to be deep for just some old sinner like Cody Zorn and like Casey to reach out and grab a hold of it. Believe it by faith. Amen. Brother Dwayne, you and Miss Joyce, come on down here if you would. Brother Dwayne Boston and Miss Joyce Boston, they've been coming to church here with us now for